matter to come before the courts, State of Ohio versus Stephen Hunt. The appellant will have, well, both sides will have 15 minutes to present oral argument. Will proceed first and may reserve up to 5 minutes for the, I'll be keeping time, so if you desire having time reserved, please let me know before you begin.
Thank you, Your Honor. May it please the court, on behalf of appellant attorney Justin Weatherly, 0078343, I would respectfully request 5 minutes for rebuttal argument.
Very well. We've read the brief, so.
Thank you very much, Your Honor. This particular appeal presents three issues that I would like this court to consider. This case stems from a motion to suppress in an OVI case, a first offense OVI case in the Akron Municipal Court, during which time a motion to suppress was filed. It was a very boilerplate motion which challenged literally everything, and specifically challenged the stop of the defendant's vehicle, arguing that it was a violation of the Fourth Amendment to the United States Constitution, as well as the Ohio Constitution, and then went on to state specifically in the motion that the only reason for the stop was the OVI checkpoint. So it's going off the Ohio Supreme Court's prior argument that all that needs to happen in a motion to suppress is you need to, with particularity, articulate the statutes, regulations, and constitutional amendments which were violated, which the motion did. It specifically referenced the Fourth Amendment as well as the Ohio Constitution, and then specifically noted that the Fourth Amendment violation occurred during the traffic stop, and then stated specifically that the traffic stop was predicated on an OVI checkpoint. That then provides notice to the state that the defense is challenging the OVI checkpoint in this case and will require testimony eliciting the constitutionality of that OVI checkpoint. At no time during the suppression hearing was there ever any testimony elicited from the state or the city with regards to the constitutionality of that checkpoint, none whatsoever. And
well,
because
counsel, the Fourth Amendment is a, not a lengthy provision, but it certainly has spawned all kinds of attacks, equal protection, due process, so on and so forth. So just mentioning that, I'm wondering how that relates to the specificity that is referenced in the case that you just cited, where the city has pointed out that at one point, you referenced the U.S. and Ohio Constitution, and then you say that your challenge is based upon the stop, but then 5 pages later, there's a reference to the checkpoint. So how does that provide notice that the checkpoint, the constitutionality of the checkpoint, is what's at issue?
Well, there is no specific statute or regulation which covers OVI checkpoints. We have case law, which has determined what it is that needs to be established for a valid checkpoint. So all we have is
those cases, I think, that were cited in the motion.
In the original motion, no, Your Honor. But again, the Supreme Court only requires statutes, regulations, and constitutional amendments to be referenced. The Fourth Amendment does govern the stops of traffic, of vehicles. It simply does. And the motion itself states that the stop itself would be challenged. And the motion states that the stop in this case was predicated on an OVI checkpoint. Ergo, we are challenging, based on the Fourth Amendment, the constitutionality of the OVI checkpoint, as that was the reason for the stop in this case. It was all laid out in the motion. There is no reason the state should not have known that the traffic stop, the OVI checkpoint in this case, would be part of a Fourth Amendment challenge during oral hearing. And it was. And the state failed to elicit any testimony as to the constitutionality. Now, I did cite State v. Goins in the closing argument for purposes only of establishing what the type of testimony that would have been required to establish the constitutionality of that particular OVI checkpoint, and to point out to the trial court that none of that evidence was ever elicited at oral hearing, and therefore this particular OVI checkpoint did not pass constitutional muster, the burden that had been placed on the state by virtue of the motion and the specific language in the motion was not met because they did fail to articulate any testimony with regards to the visibility of the checkpoint, the advance warning signs, the quantity of visibility of the officers, or any predetermined policies with regards to the advance notice of the roadblock. The requirements of a motion to suppress, as stated in the state's own brief of appellee, they're not onerous. You don't need to say, hey, we're 100% challenging these particular issues with regards to this OVI checkpoint. All we have to do is name the statutes or constitutional amendments that we believe were violated and the facts of the case to which those amendments should be applied. The facts here are we challenged the stop. The reason for the stop was the OVI checkpoint, and the basis for the challenge was the Fourth Amendment and its mirror Ohio constitutional amendment. The state was on notice. They presented zero argument as to the constitutionality of the checkpoint, and therefore, I think the trial court erred in precluding me from even arguing that. The trial court's judgment entry said that because that issue was never raised, he never had to consider it, and therefore, he would not grant a challenge to any evidence in the case based on that rationale. Now, the state argued in its brief of appellee that the court did consider it when it said that because the checkpoint was operated by law enforcement with some training, that was enough to pass constitutional muster. I argued then in my brief and reply, that's absolutely a ridiculous argument. There's no such thing as an OVI checkpoint that's not operated by police. All OVI checkpoints are operated by police. That's to say that a checkpoint is constitutional simply because police are operating it is not to undergo a constitutional evaluation of that checkpoint. So the trial court did not go under a constitutional evaluation of the checkpoint. The trial court simply precluded me from making that argument and then went on to the next, which
but
is
the
to...
The court did say that it was constitutional.
It said it was constitutional because it was operated by law enforcement with requisite specialized training. It's an exact quote from the trial court's order. I disagree that that's a constitutional analysis. The court simply ignored any constitutional analysis and did not undergo one whatsoever. Now, the court did undergo a constitutional analysis with regards to the second issue here, which is the probable cause issue. But unfortunately, the state and the trial court all relied on cases which were clearly distinguishable. In this particular case, it was an OVI checkpoint. There was no evidence of any erratic driving on the part of my client, and all of the field sobriety tests had to be suppressed because of a lack of National Highway Traffic and Safety Administration compliance. So all they had was an admission to drinking, an odor of alcohol, and what the officer described as slightly slurred speech, which, by the way, was not in the police report. That was only attested to by the officer at oral hearing. So if you take those factors, and only those factors, and you apply them to literally every appellate court case in the state of Ohio, you'll find that the courts are fairly consistent and that they do not find probable cause if you've only got that evidence. The trial court relied on State v. Sunday, which in that case noted the late hour, the Christmas holiday, the fact that there was erratic driving because the driver therein crossed the center line, there was bloodshot eyes, and there was a strong odor of mints intended to cover the odor of alcohol. Also, the defendant in that case swayed while participating in field sobriety tests. This court also relied on State v. Norman. In that case, there was slurred speech, odor of alcohol, bloodshot eyes, but in that case, the defendant therein actually failed field sobriety tests, which were admitted. And also in that case, relied on by the trial court, there was evidence of erratic driving because in that case, the defendant swerved less of center and nearly collided with the officer head-on, who ended up arresting him for the OVI. So the cases that the trial court cited had way more evidence than what was in this case. And then the state cited a case. They wanted us to follow State v. Walters, where in that case there was a strong odor of alcohol, slurred speech, bloodshot and glassy eyes, and admission to drinking 7 beers. But what the state didn't tell you is that in that case, the defendant was found with a half-naked female in his vehicle. He was highly intoxicated, according to the officer. He was behaving erratically, and oh, by the way, he took and failed field sobriety tests, which were admitted in court. So that case is clearly distinguishable. So, you know, and in our brief, Judge, we cited cases that were similar. City of South Euclid v. Bautista Avila, where there was no probable cause when they only had We had no evidence of erratic driving because it was a sobriety checkpoint. There was an odor of alcohol. There was an admission to drinking. There was alcoholic beverages in his car. He stumbled while getting out of his car, but the field sobriety tests were suppressed. No probable cause in the 8th District there. The 11th District, similarly, no probable cause for arrest when the defendant therein was speeding. Strong odor of alcohol, bloodshot or glassy eyes, significant difficulties retrieving his operator's license. But again, sobriety tests could not be considered. No probable cause.
Counsel, you're getting into your rebuttal time. You may proceed if you wish.
I'll go another 2 minutes, Judge. State v. Shulo, no probable cause for speeding, odor of alcohol, bloodshot eyes, admission to drinking, and a refusal of field sobriety test. State v. Phoenix, that's the 5th District again, no probable cause when you're driving at night without headlights, odor of alcohol, bloodshot, glassy eyes, admission to drinking, and passed the only two field sobriety tests he took. And then finally, 10th District, no probable cause in Upper Arlington v. Wissinger. Expired tags was the reason for the stop, so no erratic driving there. Odor of alcohol, admitted to drinking, and bloodshot or glassy eyes. Those are the cases that are on point with the facts here. No evidence of erratic driving, but odor of alcohol, slightly slurred speech, again, not noted in the police report, and admission to drinking. That's all the evidence that they had for arrest in this case. And if you want to add more, the officer did testify that the defendant passed the one-leg stand, so therefore he was not swaying during field sobriety tests as some of the other cases. But of course those tests were not admissible because of a lack of NHTSA compliance. And then finally, with regards to the third issue for appeal, that's a strict construction argument. Section 3701-53-04 states specifically that an instrument check shall be performed no less frequently than once every 7 days. The instrument check in this case took place 19 days prior. So, if you follow the rules, it should be every 7 days that thing is checked. You can't have a 19-day gap and then just check it 30 seconds before you run some tests, 30 seconds after, and then not check it again for another 19 days. That's what happened here. It specifically violates the administrative code. And I would ask that the evidence be suppressed on that basis as well, Your Honors.
Thank you.
Good morning, Your Honors. Brian Bremer on behalf of the State of Ohio. I want to quickly address the third sign of error that he ended, appellant ended on, because I think it's the simplest answer. There's 32 years of precedent of appellate courts in the state saying that the 7 day rule is that 7 days prior to the test that is at issue in the case. That's older, that case law has existed longer than I've been alive. There's also been 28 years of precedent out of this court adopting that ruling. And although appellant is arguing about the construction of the statute, the General Assembly and the administrative agency have known about this court precedent for 32 years, have not changed this regulation in that time. Presumably, they're okay with the way the courts have been interpreting this. So under the established precedent, this court should not suppress the breathalyzer. The breathalyzer is fine under the established appellate precedent.
I can't recall from reading the briefs whether or not this court has construed that.
Yes, this court has done it at least three times, most recent 2002, I believe. I cited the cases in my brief, but this court also did it in 1991 and 1988. So this court has a pretty strong history of construing the statute in this way. And to the extent we would overrule that precedent, the officers reasonably relied upon that precedent. And in light of that, the evidence still shouldn't be excluded because they behaved in good faith on the appellate precedent. So even assuming they
come. Something to be said, though, for the argument that 7 days, every 7 days means every 7 days. Notwithstanding how courts have interpreted it.
If the General Assembly or the administrative agency had a problem with the way the courts are interpreting it, they've had ample time to make it change. And it's presumed that when they don't make the change, they believe the courts are interpreting it in the manner that they intended. I will walk back to the probable cause issue. Appellant, if I was listening correctly, didn't mention that there's also an observation of bloodshot eyes. In addition to the strong odor of alcohol emanating from his person, the thick tongue speech, and the admission to drinking. Now, I think that's something that we need to keep in mind when we talk about the probable cause analysis, and I think that this gets lost a bit in some of the other cases that are cited by the appellant, none of which are actually in this district, the ones that have, that he says are similar but have found no probable cause, is that probable cause is not beyond a reasonable doubt. It doesn't mean more likely than not. It just is enough to warn a person of reasonable caution in the belief that a crime has occurred. And in this case, it's a person with bloodshot eyes, strong odor of alcohol, but thick tongue speech, and an admission to drinking. I think that a reasonable person would say that person is probably intoxicated. Most people don't have bloodshot eyes and odor of alcohol emanating from them if they haven't been drinking to the point of impairment.
But many of the cases, in fact, most of the cases that have been discussed by the trial court, even the case that you cited in the brief, involves either some field sobriety tests, failure of field sobriety tests, or some indication of impaired driving. And in this situation, you don't have either of those. Nobody saw the person, you know, almost strike the officer, and the field sobriety tests were not admitted.
Well, that is true that they were not admitted. I think that it's important to also keep in mind that the fact that courts have found more probable cause in other, more evidence of probable cause in other cases doesn't mean that's the bare minimum. The fact is, I will admit that this case is one where it's probably a closer call than I would prefer. Like, I think that there's, but I do think that when you hear the facts of this, if I were to tell you that I ran to someone who was slurring their speech, had bloodshot eyes, a strong odor of alcohol emanating from them, and confessed to drinking, I think that we would say that the person probably was not operating a vehicle with his full faculties, and that's all that's required. It's just supposed to be it's a reasonable inference of about what the situation is based on the facts.
But the reasonable inference relates to whether or not the individual was driving impaired.
Right, but I think the people who are not impaired probably aren't slurring their words. I think people who've only been having a drink don't have bloodshot eyes from that drink. People who have had one drink don't reek of alcohol. They don't have a strong odor coming from them. You wouldn't have something that when someone's had a beer, you don't sit there and go, oh wow, that person's been drinking. You have to get close to them before you even recognize that. And this officer here detected a strong odor of alcohol coming from the person before. And when he approached the vehicle, under the facts, there was probable cause under the standard that is espoused by the United States Supreme Court on a repeated basis, that it only needs to be enough to warn a person of reasonable caution to believe that a crime occurred. And I think that that exists in this case. I will point out also that, to the extent appellant is saying that I didn't cite all the facts from Walters, I cited all the facts that this court relied on in Walters in finding probable cause. Everything in Walters regarding probable cause is done in paragraph 16. And that's what, and I quote all of that in my brief. Appellant goes to the statement of facts for additional evidence. And this again goes to the fact that because there's additional evidence, that still doesn't mean that you have more than, that you need all that additional evidence to find probable cause. What's in my brief is what this court relied on, and I think that it's similar enough to this case. And along those lines, this, in appellant's brief, he cites a number of different cases, which are, again, his reply brief. He doesn't cite in his initial brief, leaving me with no opportunity to actually respond to all these cases that he cites for the first time. And in the 11th District case, there's no admission to drinking until after the arrest, different from this case. There's no odor of alcohol coming from the person in State versus Shulo. There's only a slight odor in State versus Phoenix, and there's no slurred speech. There's and then Upper Arlington versus Wissinger, the defendant passed two field sobriety tests that were administered correctly. Appellant is taking the position that the field sobriety tests weren't administered correctly. Well, if that's the case, then whether or not they passed, that is not indicative of anything. If they weren't administered correctly, they can't be indicative of alcohol consumption, since we don't know what probative value they would have unless they're administered correctly. And then finally, I want to approach the first assignment of error, which this court is, I think, recognize that the assignment of error is a roadmap, and his assignment of error is just that the trial court erred when it found that he didn't sufficiently raise the issue of the constitutionality of the checkpoint in his motion to suppress. Even assuming that's true, the trial court did go on to find the checkpoints constitutional. the extent that he has a problem with the way the court got there and in the court's analysis, the court should, he should have raised that as assignment of error and he should have argued it in his brief. He doesn't do that. And then in his reply brief, he develops an entire argument about what the analysis should have been. Well, that's not what the reply brief is for. Our local rules say that you can't do that. And they give me no chance to respond to it and rebut it in writing. And the reality is, he's saying, well, he's rebutting my argument. He's not. He didn't make it. My argument was he didn't make an argument in his brief. If he wants to rebut my argument, he needs to point to where in his brief he made the argument. He doesn't really do that. In his brief, he never cites authority, and he never signs it as error. And because of that, it's not being raised on appeal properly, whether or not the court got the correct answer on the constitutionality checkpoint. And therefore, the assignment of error is harmless because, assuming that the assignment of error is the same, the remedy would be for the trial court to go back and consider the constitutionality checkpoint. It already did that. There's no need to remand this at this point because the court has already given him the remedy he would get if the first time of error was sustained. And so for these reasons...
Well, he wasn't happy with the way that the court analyzed it, that it was just, you know, making short shrift of it, saying it was constitutional.
Well, if he had a problem with the way the court analyzed it, he needed to sign that as error. He didn't do that. And appellate rules are pretty clear about the fact you need to assign the errors that you think happened and you need to argue them. And when you don't do that, you don't get to then say, well, it's still not harmless because I have other issues with the decision other than what I raised. And so for these reasons, I really feel that his assignments of error should be overruled and the decision of the trial court should be affirmed.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Your Honor. Just briefly, in response to my first assignment of error, the argument is simple. The trial court's decision to preclude a constitutional challenge on the sobriety checkpoint is what we're challenging. And so the assignment of error is asking this appellate court to do is to require that the trial court undergo a constitutional analysis of the sobriety checkpoint, which was an argument that a trial order says two things. First, it says the defendant is precluded from making that argument. That's the first thing the order says. So our response is we should not be precluded from making that argument. We gave notice in the motion, and this court needs to take the evidence that was at the oral hearing, and use that evidence to determine whether or not the OVI checkpoint passed constitutionality. Now, the order goes on to say, oh, and by the way, it was a constitutional stop because it was operated by police officers who were well-trained. But that's not a constitutional analysis. What we're asking is that this court reverse the trial court's decision to preclude us from making the argument that it was not a constitutional OVI checkpoint. That is the assignment of error. It's specifically articulated in the appellant's brief. And that is what we're asking of this appellate court. Now, with regards to probable cause, I think that the state is misconstruing a probable cause for arresting someone for drinking and driving, and probable cause for someone being suspected of operating the vehicle while impaired. That's the difference here. Drinking and driving in the state of Ohio is not illegal. The state legislator has not made it illegal. So if you have an odor of alcohol, that's a sign that you've been drinking. If you have bloodshot or glassy eyes, that's a sign that you've been drinking. If you admit to drinking alcohol, that's a sign that you've been drinking. None of those things have been held by appellate courts to determine that a person has been drinking to the point of impairment. That's what field sobriety tests are for. They were not in here. That's what evidence of erratic driving is for. Again, no evidence of that here. What I cited in my brief were all of the cases that I could find where there was no field sobriety test for one reason or another, and no erratic driving for one reason or another. And in all of them, there was no probable cause because an odor of alcohol, slightly slurred speech, as stated by the officer, which again was not in his police report, an admission to drinking, as well as bloodshot or glassy eyes, those are all signs that someone has been drinking, not signs that someone is too impaired to operate their motor vehicle. Signs that someone is too impaired to operate a motor vehicle include a lack of motor coordination, being confused, or actually not being able to control their vehicle. And there was no evidence here that my client couldn't control his vehicle. There was no evidence presented here that he had a lack of motor coordination. There were no field sobriety tests. There was no erratic driving. There were simply signs that he had been drinking, not that he had been drinking to the point.